told at that meeting is that, like in this case, the city would have to be the applicant, and then ODOT would be the funder, and that those funds could potentially be used for lighting or other safety improvements along the complete corridor. And so I'd love to hear more information about if the city has any intention on acting on that grant. That's the first part of that question. And the second part would be for Savannah, if there's some statute of limitations or time after which it's no longer considered a rapid response because you have exceeded some time frame in your eligibility for funds.
So to answer the first part of that question, the plan is to explore that rapid, I'm getting it confused with the beacon, the rapid response grant for that illumination. So looking to ODOT's work that they're doing now at the Chapman location, once they come up with a design and a plan, then the city would submit for a grant to do the same thing at the other three locations.
So regarding the second question, I know that this rapid response grant, it's within 24 months of an incident. I don't know how long that funding is available for, but I can definitely look into it. I know it's a reoccurring process that's available, so I'll have to look and see if there's actually a deadline, but I know it's reoccurring.
24 months from the time of application or from the time of project completion?
I'll have to go and look at that. And I'll clarify that for sure.
And Savannah, when you get those, there's a number of questions that folks are following up on. You can send those to me. I'll put them up on the Facebook page and send them off to Jay and Rebecca to distribute all the ways that things get distributed.
My question is for, I think, both Mary and Savannah. So has there been any consideration in installing a permanent light at Southwest Twin Oaks Circle, but rather than the one that was directly across from Chapman, the one that comes in on the south side of Papa's Pizza? I asked for a couple of reasons. Number one, a lot of people are coming in and out of that. If anybody lives there or works in businesses back there, there's homes, businesses, parking lot, yep. People try to turn left there and wait hours sometimes to try to go downtown, number one. Number two, that can create a lot of bottleneck for people coming in and out, particularly during rush hours. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if most of the incidents we've had in this region are between 7 and 9 in the morning and probably 5 and 7 in the evening. But installing one there would also slow traffic down as it started to approach downtown, and as it went away, there's also about a block from Crystal Lake, so it would mimic more of what's going on as you approach downtown, where you have to stop every block anyway. But it would also eliminate the need for people to have to cross between the co-op. It's not that much distance for them to continue to have to move, but it would be a permanent light, much more like the one that's in other parts of the world. Just a thought.
Yeah, thank you. It's not on my radar, but I'll definitely take note of that.
Is there any plan to return the 4th Street to 3rd Street? Return it once after before they did the bypass?
Not to my knowledge, no.
There was a new turn from 4th Street to 3rd Street to return to Corvallis. Okay. Is there any plan to return that?
Not to my knowledge, unless the city has knowledge of that. No.
Yep. So I wonder about looking at what did happen, how are we doing things differently so it wouldn't happen that way again? And in particular, this delay of something to take a year to address the problem. And I don't think that the timeline for ordering equipment and doing all the studies that you talked about, I don't think that's going to change. So I have heard a little bit about some measures we're taking in this particular example, where maybe we're trying to have a little more inventory for quick replacement of things, and we're thinking about having signs up to let people know that a light's not working. But I wonder if either of you could speak to maybe a different approach to having a temporary solution that addresses the safety issue and doesn't allow a safety issue to remain in place for that kind of a duration. Is that something that we can do, or we are doing, or we look into?
So I think that there's a couple of things that ODOT is doing just holistically that is unique and new to the agency. And so one of the things that is recently being implemented is called our Blueprint for Urban Design. And this is a process, but this is a look that ODOT is completely new to me as an ODOT employee. It's really looking at the context of the facility. So not waiting until we see incidents occur or tragedies occur, but really looking at the context of the facilities and designing to it. And that's one of the things that we'll be implementing in the facility plan, which I think it's a huge step in the right direction.
Well, I'm glad you brought up the facility plan because that's what my question is about.
Okay.
So South Corvallis has done a lot of work planning for the renewal district. And so I'm curious how this long-range facility plan for Third Street is going to interact with our urban renewal work, which is just launching right now. So probably our district isn't going to be mature for another 10 years. So how does the plan that's going to evolve over the next 2 years, how is that going to work with our urban renewal district going forward?
So one of the things that we are also working on is our planner who's managing the facility plan is very engaged in the city efforts when it comes to, like, we're going to get this from the South area. Thank you. Yes. And so there is some coordination that is happening because it is very important that we're understanding the land uses, that we're understanding any future urban renewal districts, and coordinating that with our facility plan. So there is going to be a joint effort. They're kind of simultaneously happening, so it's unique, but it's on our radar.
I think that maybe what I heard in your question too, in terms of opportunities to make changes because of the maturity of the urban renewal district as the taxes come along. So I'm not an urban renewal district expert, so I say something wrong and something not the right answer. But I believe that there's a set of projects that have been identified for what those tax dollars can be spent on. So it doesn't mean that those projects couldn't move forward, it just might mean that we're looking for a different revenue stream from them. So again, that can happen sometimes.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Okay. In any discussion about, or just looking at this map and just kind of overall plan for the future, have you thought of a light rail or a streetcar for downtown? Or next to me.
We do have the city transit service, which is fareless and operates at a high frequency that we continue to keep trying to enhance. And we do have a circulator for downtown too now, so you don't have to get off at Fifth Street and walk downtown. You can make a change at Fifth Street, the transit mall, and take the bus to downtown.
Yeah, so part of my question is my recollection of weight limit on the bridge in Harrisburg diverted truck traffic from Highway 99 East to 99 West. And I wonder if that's a permanent, there seemed to be a big uptick in truck traffic. I wonder if that's a permanent change. But I wanted to step back and talk about a broader issue, and that's that bikes and pedestrians are second class citizens in this state. And they've been that way for years. You look at the state ODOT budget, you look at the city budget, you look at the DA's office that doesn't enforce reckless driving, you look at the police that don't charge people with reckless driving, you look at paint along a major highway is considered a bicycle thoroughfare. I don't know if they do that anywhere else in the world, but let's think about improving our bicycle infrastructure so people want to go from one place to another without a car. Now, part of that in big cities, and we're becoming a big city, is by making car traffic less convenient, forcing people to do something else. But bicycle boulevards, things that get people off of the busy streets and make it easier for them to get where they're going, beyond just the focus on Third. But then with the focus on Third, is there a way for protected bike lanes, something a little tougher, sturdier that protects people?
So I'll answer the first part of that. In the city of Corvallis transportation system plan, which was just adopted in 2018, there is an unprecedented shift towards bicycle and pedestrian projects. And part of that is creating a low-stress network to do just what you said, try to get people off of those arterial collectors, busy streets, and give them a safe alternative. There's a couple of options that are in the TSP in South Corvallis to try to unload the, well, definitely on the east side, I'm not 100% sure on the west side, to make that transition and try to make it more attractive so that people will use those modes.
And regarding the buffer bike lanes, one of the beautiful things, in my own opinion, about Highway 99 is that there is a lot of space there. One of the things that the Highway 99 facility plan can address, well, let me take a step back. One of the challenges of Highway 99 is it's a freight route, as you just mentioned, with the freight traffic. So it is designated a freight route, which provides certain standards that we have to follow as well. Now, I referenced the blueprint for urban design, which really, again, looks at the context of the facility, and buffered bike lanes could very well be a potential as part of that effort. It's part of the analysis, but yes, there's context to take into account for a facility like Highway 99.
And I would just say to the budget part, that's on the legislature in terms of what happens in terms of ODOT and that budget and the transportation process. And I think part of what the conversation is right now about moving towards less carbon intensive participation modes, and that obviously is not the easiest discussion in the world to have. But I would think we agree that we need to be moving in that direction.
Hi, thank you so much for all the thoughts and work that's gone into this. I've been a bicyclist in Corvallis without a car for 30 years, and I avoid the streets of the main streets of Corvallis. But based on what I just said, I'm going to start trying to really safely be on those powerful streets in order to keep reminding cars that there are bikes out there. And admittedly, it's very, really avoid, but I'm going to put all my flashing, all my big bright lights on and be present there. One thing I haven't heard that I run into on a regular basis is cars where I cannot see into the windows. They have the black window. I cannot make eye contact with them without walking in front of their car. Is there something we can do so that I can be able to know that they see me and I see that they're stopped and they are committed to that until I pass?
Yeah, that is a good question, and I don't know that I have an answer for you. I think that's a real issue. So from ODOT's perspective, I don't have an answer on that. I don't know if you...
That's an enforcement issue.
Hi, I'm Jeff Warren. I'm a patrol with the Corvallis Police Department. And what you're describing, the blacked out passenger side or driver's side windows, it's a violation if it's blacked out. There is a tint level that is set. And if the tint is so dark beyond a certain percentage, that's an enforcement issue. And we do have motor officers. Come in, report the violation after being sworn in. Report the violation. If the judge finds that there still merits the citation going forward, then the citation gets sent back to an officer to issue to the violator. There is a pathway for that to happen. It is not used very often, but it does come in occasionally. And yes, you can legitimately issue a citizen citation for violations you observe.
Thank you, Lieutenant. All right, we are just about out of time. There are three that I've seen earlier that I have made eye contact to and said I was going back. Here's one.
I just want to repeat Andy's question because I didn't hear the answer. Andy asked, and I'm going to phrase it yes or no. The trucks were rerouted from 90.
99 East to 99 West, will they be rerouted back to 99 East in the coming future? Yes or no?
I don't have an answer for you. So I don't know enough about that particular issue to give you a yes or no response, but it's something that I can look into.
So, and how do we find out?
I'll follow up.
So you'll find out?
Yes, I will find out, okay. And I will follow up with you.
Okay, yes. So you will, I'm just checking, you're not following up with.
Well, I was going to let you know. Yeah. Okay, well, yes, I will get your contact information.
I think what she meant to say is she'll get the answer, give it to you to put on your website, like as a way to get the information to everybody to see what the answer is.
Okay.
Not that you didn't
have
the answer.
Me because I don't know the
answer. I was just wondering, as a bicyclist and pedestrian, is there any way for a citizen to have input for the ODOT planning so that we can plan walkways and make Third Street more pedestrian friendly in the future?
Yes, so we will have a stakeholder list for the facility plan, Highway 99 facility plan. I can get you the contact, if you hang out for just a minute, I can get you the contact information for that. I don't believe there is a website up quite. No, there is a, I think there is a facility, a Highway 99 facility plan, a website currently up, but there is a stakeholder mailing list, so you can be involved in that process.
Related question, is the extent south of the looks at 99, does it go all the way to River Green?
It goes to the city limits.
Yeah. Okay. Because that's one of the speed limits that did not change, is that transition between the 35 to 50 and everybody's going 50 in the 35.
Okay.
Before you have to turn
over
to the issue.
Okay.
Especially if the pedestrians and bikes tend to cross. Now there's businesses across there, so.
Thank you.
My concern is the coffee place that has been approved and is going in this summer or the spring that is on the block between Crystal Lake and Chapman, and how it's a drive-through coffee place, how that is being, the impact of that, a drive-through place in an area that is already a disaster in terms of our traffic. How is that being looked at, and what is Public Works and ODOT planning to do to make that somewhat safer with right and left turns?
Yes, so Savannah had said something earlier about looking at how we reduce conflicts, especially in that Chapman area because of the bad sight lines. And that's part of that conversation that will occur with the facility plan is, do we make some kinds of changes there so people can't take whatever direction they want to go, that they're forced to only do certain turn movements to reduce those cross street conflicts? It's something that will be part of that.
So I know that I said, but I just see the last two and they've gone fast. So I know who you are, it's you and you.
So here we go.
How many people have to die before the city of Corvallis decides to enforce the speed limit? We can put up all the signs in the world. People are not driving the speed limit. The lights flashing at them too fast, slow down, and they continue to drive that speed. They're not being ticketed. They will continue to do it. FedEx drivers all driving 35 through the 25 zone. It's not being enforced.
So one of the things that I wonder, harkening back to the conversation we had before, did you say that there was some data about enforcement after the flashing lights went on or the compliance?
From that date up until the end of February, we have had a total of, looks like 101 citations, 105 warnings in addition to those citations, 33 extra patrols, that's basically an officer checking themselves out at that location, but not having a necessarily any type of enforcement activity while there. So the total is 239